My name is Huiphei van der Werf. As mentioned, I'll be your chair today. That means I have the honor of basically making sure that the discussion and the conversation we'll be having is continuous and has a flow to it. As Andrea mentioned, in terms of the position of privileged, I'd like to expand the notion of not just the artist, but the cultural producer, as today we are all privileged to be here and to hear the positions and the ideas and the concepts of not only artists, but sociologists, architects, and activists from a great many places. It's not just the Netherlands, it's Germany, it's Palestine, it's Slovenians that are based in Germany. It's very diverse. And therefore, actually, I'm going to keep this short. I have two questions. That is that we see what kind of topics we'll be discussing today range from the role of art in the public realm, alienation and appropriation, urban feudalism. These are very varying and very dynamic. My question, therefore, for all of us is that we really see which line we're going in terms of the composition of the day. For those of you that weren't here yesterday, you can see this day as actually being composed. And I hope, therefore, we can count on you to take part in the discussion. As a moderator, I'll be very interested and keep a very close eye out on the audience to see who has any questions for our speakers when they're finished giving their presentation. And that brings me actually to my second question. It's a very practical one. Please make sure that your mobile phones are switched off, and maybe even though you think you switched it off, just have a look and just make sure that it's on the silent mode, because there's nothing more distracting in the concentration of giving a presentation than a lovely ringtone, no matter if it's Lady Gaga or Beethoven. I'm sure no one has a preference there. That brings me actually to privilege yet again. Our first speaker, Marjetica Potrč, will be giving a presentation on basically the future city and the artist as a mediator. There's a lot of promise in that, I think, and there's a lot of notion of the community, the communal, which was discussed yesterday. So I think we're continuing on a good note, and I propose we get right to it. So Marjetica, thank you very much for being here and for kicking us off today.
Thank you. So yeah, I'm happy to be with you today. And I will basically talk about, I will compare informal city of Caracas with a neighborhood in west side of Amsterdam. And I'll try to explain what they have in common. But before I'll do this, there are those two slides. And yesterday, there a lot of speakers talked about the Occupy Wall Street movement. And just at the end of the day, I said, oh my God, I also have the first slide. It's about Occupy Wall Street movement, which was quite amazing. So here we go. But I have another perspective on this. The two slides don't show actually the like criticism of the distribution of wealth, but they actually talk about the change of perception, how we think about the world community today. And the left slide shows, it's a cover page of a catalog that was published just 4 years ago by the Cooper Hewitt Museum in New York. And the title of the exhibition was Design for the Other 90%, implying that the others are like someplace else, and we are the 10% who are looking at the exhibition. In 4 years, and now this has changed, and suddenly we are the 99%. But this also gives us hope to see the society as an organism. And I would say that societies of the world are an intelligent organism, and when it's necessary, they self-generate new models of existence and coexistence. Why is this important? Because existence and coexistence is given, but how we practice is not given. So practice is really important today, at least I think also in my practice. Okay, we go on. So, what can we learn from these very different, like at first sight, very different sites? One is modernist neighborhood in West part of Amsterdam, and the other one is the informal city. And I'm just thinking about how actually we hear, like, they formally look very different. But how we, but can we think about what can we learn about those two sides for our future, and how indeed we think about the future today? Yesterday, Miguel, I would like to quote Miguel's friend who said, "Well, it's first time I don't think that my existence is linked to something post something, but it's actually opening, my existence opens a new chapter for, let's say, for the humanity." It was a very grand statement. But then at the same time, I would like to have another quote for you, which is a quote by George Orwell, who said, "Who controls the past controls the future. Who controls the present controls the past." Which means, how do we think about the past today? Are those models like a neighborhood, modernist neighborhood in distress and informal city, are these forms of the past, or can we learn from them? Also, the question is also, can we learn from the communities that live outside of the illusion of a stable modernity? So here we are, this is my little sketch, because I try to understand also in my mind what the two communities propose, like the informal city of Caracas and neighborhood in Amsterdam, the communities who live there. And the thing is that the present is always very messy. And we don't, it's very hard to understand somehow what's going on. But at the same time, it also grounds us. What we do today actually has consequences for tomorrow. So I think it's important to think about the present today. And also, is the present of those communities that live outside of the illusion of stable modernity, is this our future? And if yes, let's look what they propose, or what, how they live, actually. So the city, in their view, is a network of neighborhoods and not metropolis. They emphasize shared space. You can also say community space, and not public space. They also emphasize control of land and space, and not so much ownership of land and space. So controlled community space becomes very important. But here I would also like to say that it's this temporary condition of the space, it's actually not permanent space, but it's temporary space. What is sort of fantastic is that space bounced back as a very important entity. Space became, in the times of constant migrations that we also experience in our lives, space became a very important category. Then what about people? It's in their view, social architecture is very important, maybe more important than architecture itself. Architecture, as you know, was a big thing during the 20th century, or discourse about architecture. And then collectivity and sharing, and of course, not individualism and owning. I try to make versus. And the culture of living becomes very important, new culture of living, and the old culture is linked to consumerism and entertainment in this nice sketch. So suddenly what we have is this sort of a monster, the local. We focus on the local, the small, and the independent. And I would like to just also have another quote, which is actually the quote from the right-wing government of the Great Britain, David Cameron. When he got into power, there was this big talk about big society. And he said, well, we are actually, what we are doing is we are giving it's groundbreaking shift of power to local councils and communities. And I was totally struck by it, because this is exactly the statement that you would expect from left-wing president of Venezuela, Hugo Chavez. So just to tell you that we are already there, we are in the local, but what is the local, where is the local, and who is the local is a big question. I should just like go very fast through this. So small communities and strong neighborhoods that the Caracas informal city and the neighborhood in Amsterdam propose, is this good or bad? Beyond this question, I think it's good to point to categories that they think are important. One is sustainability. The cities are, in the cities, people are the most important sustainable element, not only natural resources. And participation, and I was just talking with Harp before about this. It's very interesting that this the word participation re-emerged or emerged in a very strong way. We say participatory democracy and participatory design, but just somehow to remind us that this is what a democracy and design should be. It should be participatory. So all these community based projects and also sharing of knowledge actually are just reminding us that participation is very important, including the Occupy Wall Street movement. Then another thing which is important is self-organization and self-sustainability. And I would like just to point to the fact that a few years ago when I talked at the NICE Institute of Architecture in Rotterdam, it was architects that really went against me when I was talking about self-sustainability, because in their mind it was linked to autarky or a system that is self-segregating. However, I see it as a potential of reimagining the power between individual and the society. And when we see that the social state is on the way out, we will see, just it's natural to see more initiatives where the individual takes initiative, but of course there is a question how much you can contribute to the larger society. And then at the end, society is an organism way beyond, you know, the rational society. I think we are like very close to the natural world. And what I have learned from also from the Amsterdam project here in 2009, I learned a lot from the ritual, not so much about function and the rational. Okay, let's go. So, Caracas, 2003, is a Caracas. They called it Dos City of. It's actually two cities, Dos Ciudades. So, what are these cities? It's a formal and informal city, and I like this slide so much because it shows somehow the flowing of the informal city onto the formal city. When my family visited me in Caracas, they went to the tourist office and they got a map which showed the formal city, but informal city was presented as a green wild nature, which was totally hysterical because wherever you stood, you know, the informal city was present like this because of course it grows up on the hills. But then it was only after I was working in Amsterdam in 2009 that ideas that I started to rethink what informal city is all about. And the big division between formal and informal city, actually what I learned is that it's division between urban and rural culture. And I'll try to explain. People who live in informal city, they come from rural background. And they are also the ones that build the formal city. So it would be very simple for them just to replicate the form of the modernist architecture. But they insisted on the what I call rural architecture. Why? Because it produces village communities. Okay. I'll just move. Okay. There was it produces village communities. Let's go back because it's easier to visualize. The informal architecture also adapts much clearly, and it's small scale. It has ability to adapt, and it's actually also to change. It actually talks about shared space and not public space. For instance, when you are walking in Caracas Barrio, there is no public space per se. It's just shared space that can shift to a community space or to private space. And then you, as a user of it, you have to negotiate your route through the barrio. Then what was also interesting is there is always this myth of informal architecture that talks about informal architecture as a chaos. But actually, barrios are highly regulated entities. It's just they are regulated through oral regulation and not through written regulation. Let's see. What the two slides also now talk about, it's actually the challenge. The left slide shows architecture, which is somehow falling apart, but it's not the biggest question in the barriers are not, is not architecture. It's actually a message. The water pipes are have a message to tell. We have to rethink relationship between architecture and infrastructure, also in our cities today. And the right slide talks about that we have to rethink relationship between individual and the state. In 2003, Venezuela was basically a state in non-existence, and the social state was also non-existence. So what you see on the right side are like street sellers that are hawking their goods on a public highway. Now just quickly through like how a barrio becomes a structure. It starts usually in a very ad hoc manner. It's a shelter assembled, but of course also it's an invasion on the public land. But then it gets very quickly upgraded. And the people, for instance, this is what I call a study of the growing house. And when we communicated a lot with the lady of the house, and what we see here is actually how the house, the process of the house growing. When she moved there, let's say 10 years ago, her house was positioned just across the street from electricity pole. Today it is in the middle of the house, which became sort of a mansion. And she was actually complaining, we talked with her a lot, she was complaining that now she's so high up, she cannot build another floor. So we tried here not only to learn from residents who live there, but also to think what we can, like from their perspective of this rural architecture, how we can inform the former city, which was down in the valley. So the project that I worked with on is a dry toilet. It's this little white building in the middle of the landscape. And the dry toilet is an ecologically safe toilet that doesn't need any water to operate. And of course, we are talking about the site in a barrio with no access to running water. In the more privileged areas of the barrios, you would get running water, but only twice per week for a few hours. So water was a very important issue. And when I'm interested as an architect and an artist in issues of sustainability, and when I ask people whether they would be interested to, let's say, upgrade their electricity, the way how they use electricity, they said, no, there's no question, we don't want any solar panels or anything like this, because anyway we can get the electricity from the power grid, which means they were just stealing electricity. It was very interesting to see that they didn't see that, you know, their relationship to the larger community. So, but the idea, the lack of water was a different thing. And when we, so there, we had a lot of discussions, of course, in the community, but also I have to tell you that, for instance, I don't design such objects. I think the dry toilet was very important relational object for the community to change the way how they do things and also to change a culture, but I don't design this. We, for instance, I share the knowledge between different people and different disciplines. It's very important to learn together to find new solutions. And in the case of the dry toilet, we flew in an architect from New York who was Mexican, and she talked with the community, and then we developed a kind of a toilet that was more adaptable to the humid conditions of Venezuela. And of course, what was also important in the project was the fact that there was this local construction community that now has the know-how, and actually they are empowered to continue to build the project again and again. This is just like a photo of the relational object when it was finished and the owner. And here we see inauguration day, where actually it was very important because it was it was acknowledgement from the former city. There was a minister of environment who came up the hill. Of course, in Venezuela, this time, formal and informal city, as I said before, it was a divided city. So the thing again is that we have the same challenges. We have to live together. So this was when the Minister of Education or Environment came up the hill, this was an acknowledgement for the community that they are a part of the city. And this is like for me very important also in the view of the things that are going on in Medellin right now when previous mayor, Sergio Fajardo, initiated projects, cultural and educational projects that are linking formal and informal city together. So that's insight. And here we are. So how I'm doing? Okay. So we are in Amsterdam 2009, and it's a project which is a community garden and community kitchen in New West district of Amsterdam. I have just to tell you that at the time we were told when we started to develop a project there that New West district is experiencing redevelopment, which is the biggest residential redevelopment in European Union. Mostly populated, there's a lot of immigrants who live and in the area who are not well integrated. So it's a sort of a typical project by what's happening now with modernist developments that were built in second half of last century. But then what we learned from the community, it's not about redevelopment, but it's somehow what I call rebuilding a city. Because rebuilding a city, in their view, is to rebuild how we live together. So it was not redevelopment, it was rebuilding how we live together. In a way, it was also the project was beautiful because it tried to reimagine the idea of the garden city, because the New West District was designed by Van Eastern in 1934, built after the Second World War, as a garden city, as a Dutch take on the garden city, which tried in a way to rethink what was there before, which was a farmland. And what we get to today is actually a new garden city, a garden city of the 21st century. I'll talk about it later. The project was a collaborative project. I was invited by the Stedelijk Museum to make an on-site project in the city, The Stedelijk Museum, the curator Leontine, she was great. She was all the time a big supporter of the project. But what for me was really important was the collaborative project with Wilde Westen, a group of architects and artists, cultural producers that are basically based in Amsterdam and Rotterdam, and who used to analyze the same area. And we had similar dreams. We worked very closely together to think about what to do, and of course together with residents, that when you walk down the streets, you actually couldn't see any residents. So we were asking, where are the residents? And in a way, the project also offered a chance to do something, because typically when you would talk to with residents, they would say there is nothing is possible. So we made something possible that for them was not possible, and which empowered their community. So what else should I say here? The project was a success, but I'll talk just while going through the slides. Just a reminder about the idea of the Garden City, which was first put in writing by Ebe Zener Howard. I never know how to say his name. And the main idea was about three magnets. One is the town, one is the country, one is town-country. So this the balance between the town and the country. Of course, it's the end of 19th century, and the cities are clogged by industry, so there was populated by slums. So, you know, it was this idea that we should bring the nature in, and the whole project, also this, the Cook the Farmer, was also doing it, but in a different way. So this is a photo, like on the left, photo from maybe 70s, and view from above how the neighborhood looks today. And then there is just like a short history of the site. It's only 50 years ago, this was a farmland. Then Garden City descended on the farmland and tried to incorporate the green in some way, or to reimagine the green. And then what was like when you see this, the fourth slide, it talks about cake green, which is a fenced off space. But maybe I should just start from the beginning. So in the 1970s, of course, first of all, as with many modernist projects, there was a lot of money for architecture, but not for social activation of the social space. So in the 70s, what you are looking at are these open public spaces that actually talked about open society. So open space at the time meant open society. However, in the 80s, the same space meant no man's land. So this thing in the 70s, the success of the open space, open democracy in the 70s was just like a good coincidence. But then the same space 10 years after, it meant no man's land. In 90s, the same space became fenced off. And cake green is a form that I first met here in the Netherlands that actually you enclose the public space. And people who live around it, they have to pay for maintenance of the public space, but they have no right to visit the space. So it's called cake green, if I understand correctly, looking only garden. We opened such a garden for a community to use as a community garden. But also for me, what was super interesting was that I learned this, but maybe I'm wrong, this is what I remember, this is what I have in my mind, that in 2004, the city of Amsterdam gave the public space to housing corporations to manage it, or they loaned it for a long period of time. And in this way, the link between, this democratic link between people and the municipality was broken, because when we worked in the on the site, we realized that actually the municipality was basically just facilitating housing corporations. Housing corporations, of course, had no interest in the public land. And when they redesigned the space, they only tried to shrink it. But I think this the importance, some people also yesterday talked about the importance of the democracy. I think it's very important that people have this participation of democracy where you have the elected government actually can represent your voice, which I think it didn't exist in this case. So this is Ashan Herta, and what we are looking at is the ideas that the community brought together for us and how we understood them. First of all, they wanted to live in a small and strong neighborhood, not in a metropolis, as I said before. And this neighborhood was sort of a very interesting thing. It reminded us of the 19th century, but of course it's a new kind of neighborhood that they had in mind. And I would say it's community-based, it's idea of community-based regionalism. So it's somehow it's a different way of mapping the city. Again, they went for community space, not public space. Then also what was very important was the placemaking, which again is temporary, but the space is very important. You have to get grounded in the space, even if you're in movement between one or the other location, and that's it's ritualistic. And then also social architecture, as I said before, it's important beyond the formal architecture. What was also very, for them a big issue was to reimagine the rural and urban coexistence. And of course you can say that community garden is one such phenomena because we start to cultivate the food inside the city. The community garden started with 22 families. There were 30 at the end with very mixed ethnic groups working together. But there were three categories that I think were important. Reclaiming land, which meant for them, if I reclaim the land, I reclaim my community and I reclaim my city. But beyond this was a really, it was a process of a ritual, a very symbolic process. It was like living in a rite of passage together with people who were dealing with community garden. And working together, I would just remind you that we usually think of working together as in a negative way, is some kind of, as a recovery process after some kind of catastrophe. But today we think it as a positive idea because we see empowerment, people are empowered by working together. And also they gain new knowledge. A lot of people also yesterday were talking about sharing and getting new knowledge that is possible by different communities living together and working together. And then there was another sort of hysterical thing, working on the land. And working on the land is, why would you struggle and spend all your afternoons working with the land. It was for me also a very ritualistic idea. And here you can clearly see that the green or the rural component in the city becomes catalyst for change. But it also tells you that the cities today are cities in transition. And I'll try to explain. We looked a little bit in the history, cultivation of food in cities. And usually we think as a crisis mentality. On the left side you see urban agriculture in 1943 in Berlin. On the right side at the same time, during Second World War, it's Victory Gardens in front of the White House. It's Eleanor Roosevelt's project. And by the way, now Michelle Obama is doing similar thing. And then, this was before, it was the crisis mentality, and here it's the big desire. So suddenly cultivating food together and to be involved in community garden becomes a big desire. On the left side you see Alison Waters and the edible garden in California in the US, and she was one of the advisors at the beginning of Obama administration. On the right side you see lunch at the Cook the Farmer, the garden that we worked in. It's sort of a déjeuner sur l'herbe. It's really this sort of utopia that we desire today. which just tells you that we are cities in transition. And I will just draw two parallels between how that allotments did the same thing. On the left side, you see a typical allotment garden in Germany. They had the same function when the city transformed from the, when citizens moved from rural areas to cities at the beginning of Industrial Revolution. So there was this, an idea of allotment, so you were working on the land in some kind of a rite of passage again. And the thing is that allotments were usually dislocated in areas which were not functional, in a functional city. And the gardens, there is one garden is for one family. However, on the right side, you see a typical community garden, which is located in the middle of the city, and people share food. So it's not only for one family, it's also about sharing. I think I should just move very quickly now. 10 minutes, okay. Placemaking. Again, I'm talking about the community kitchen. When we wanted to move out of this discourse of the project, the groups within New West started to fight who will control the space after we leave. And then we learned how placemaking is very important for them, not just that a group needs to have a space, but also there is again the shift that community space is super important and not public space. I'll just move quickly. That's a side. This is a similar garden to our garden. The photo was taken the same day as the next one. So this is exactly how our garden looked like a year ago, and then this is how it looked 1 year afterwards. I think it's just amazing. It's really this green utopia. And sometimes I include my drawings, as you see. So there was this DNA, the left drawing shows this DNA line, how actually the garden city of the 20th century is transformed into a garden city of the 21st century on the top, with, of course, a different distribution of people and activities. So exchange, I'll just have a few words to say on each slide. Exchange of knowledge here. Security was totally heightened after, the security improved with the project, and we understood that added values are the poor, the security, and also community space. Cultivating food, each of the community garden is a classroom to learn political rights. So what comes first, chicken or egg, architecture or people? This community said it's the people. It's a social architecture, not architecture. And this, of course, wouldn't be possible without a lot of involvement from people in the neighborhood. We first thought about this project as being a global project, like connecting with the global community gardens, but it became very local, which I think was the strength of the project. So I'll just go. This is Latin Sister Design Production workshop. And what I think is super interesting about Latin Sister Design Production team is they don't sell products, but they tell you, they recycle what we have, but they also tell you how to do it yourself. And again, it's an emphasis on sharing and not owning. And I would just like to tell you that somehow we also experience this different idea of what is freedom. Freedom is not freedom to choose an object on a shelf in a supermarket. Freedom is to choose responsibility in a community network. So just a few photos. A swamp also worked. We constructed the compost together. This was also interesting. It was vandalism on the window, which actually showed that the project was well integrated and it made important impact in the community. So harvest party, time of celebration, which is again a ritual you have to celebrate when you go through a passage. This was the time that community took care of the space. And here again we have this totally bucolic idea of this community garden as some kind of an Eden or a paradise. Now, what was very interesting for me was some photos that a photographer took of people in the garden. And as you see, as you can imagine, the project was very successful. It was cultivation of food and sharing. It was multicultural coexistence, but it was also it meant healing of wounds of migration. So in a way, it was a very successful project. However, people here in the photos look somehow lost and powerless. And basically they were asking questions, what will happen, can we really change the redevelopment? Is this really about rebuilding the city or it's about redevelopment? And when we left, a committee was formed with by eight residents took over the project. I think I should just go fast because I would like to talk a little bit about comparison of Caracas and Amsterdam. So this is the photo shows how people in our garden who built, residents in our garden who built the greenhouse are telling others how to follow their example. And to tell you the truth, this is like one of the important issues also that we learned. These projects are always temporary. We don't talk today about the permanent projects. Everything that we experience also in our lives is temporary, but the space again is very important. Now, the big lesson that I learned that from Caracas is actually it's two cultures. And my thesis is that rural culture, which in the case of Amsterdam is community garden, in the case of Caracas, it's informal architecture, which produces village communities, that the rural culture is catalyst for change in our cities in transition. And we can talk about what comes out, it's small and resilient communities, it's a shared space, it's protection of local culture, knowledge and territory, it's oral communication and regulation. And this is typical also what we saw yesterday about this, the Occupy Wall Street movement, people talk, it's very important to talk. But more like what I want to say is why these community-based projects are so important, because they produced an object. But I call it a relational object because it's not enough just to talk. You have to do something through which you process your change of culture, and this I think is important. So this is the slide that didn't work, and actually it showed urban and rural culture in Caracas, but this shows. The suddenly rural culture in the middle of Amsterdam. Shared space in Amsterdam, in Caracas, again, a very temporary condition. Shared space in Amsterdam is somehow temporary, but now highly desirable. Collectivity and sharing. Collectivity became like also a big issue for both communities. It's not only sharing knowledge within the community, but also reaching to others, as the community in Caracas reached to people in the former city of Caracas, also the community in west side of Amsterdam. They reached to people who live in the center of Amsterdam, who came, and because before they wouldn't come because it was too dangerous to go there, and now because of the project they came and shared with people there. And at the end, sustainability and self-sustainability, as I said at the beginning, questions of how much a particle can contribute to the larger society is super important today when the social state is disintegrating or in the case of Caracas doesn't exist. I would like to end with this drawing. its relationship between culture and art. Many people today also, like speakers today, they talked about the relationship between culture and art. And I think that what is really important is the culture, because art actually depends on culture. It's connected, because art depends on culture, but then art is also a tool to change culture. So it makes a loop, but first, main question is, what is culture? And I would like to say that art mediates our relationship with the world. I call myself in such projects artist as a mediator. I think that artists can have several practices, and maybe I would like just to mention that social critique that artists use today is very popular, and community-based projects seem to be very messy and a little bit mad, but they aim to the same thing, which is change of culture. So just like to remind you that community-based projects are not outside the system, but very much inside. And this is the last slide, which actually talks that the rural culture can be catalyst for change in our cities in tradition. That's all. I hope I was not too long.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Marjetica, for that very inspiring, and I think I speak for a lot of us, a wonderful beginning for this day. Thank you also, you were exactly on time. Not a minute more, not a minute less. That also is appreciated, because then we can have questions for you. You mentioned the artist as a mediator, also in the possibility of a change in culture. The vehicle for that, it seems, in a lot of your slides, is this idea, this understanding of the potential of the local, really looking at a situation and exactly the ingredients there that are there, and the artist or cultural producer being the one to organize it and in order to make that change. Would you like a glass of water? Oh, your microphone, right. Could you maybe tell a little bit more about how this notion of the local as a vehicle between this idea of a past and a future? We're in the present now. I'd like to hear a little bit more about your position on that, because in one of your slides you said this notion of city gardening, I believe it was, is the end of the modern era. I'm just wondering what the new dawn is then in that. How does this past and this future?
No, city gardening is actually placed very much in the beginning of new era. Mm-hmm.
This idea of the local as a vehicle between the past and the future.
Well, you know, in a way it's very easy. You know, after we live in the world of globalization, it's the local that popped up. And what is for me very interesting that also politicians are aware of it. And we are already living in this local condition, but because we are still somehow drawn or based in the idea of a modernist state and, you know, like the idea of equality and equal distribution of wealth, it's sort of hard to think that our cities today are where, like, the population already also segregates already. You know, rich people tend to live together and poor people tend to live together. So we are already living in a very different landscape that was there 50 years ago, or not so long ago.
Do your projects specifically intend to have a solution for that situation? I mean, are you looking for example, the project in Caracas, the minister did come to visit, so there is a recognition, there is an empowerment in the people who have realized the project, that they've done something that's been recognized.
Yeah.
But is there more than just that in creating a bridge between the formal and the informal city, the rich and the less privileged?
Well, you know, this was the time of beginning of Hugo Chavez's government, and first thing what he did is he started to distribute the land to people who already had the houses in the informal city. So they became all owners. What I think is super interesting is that the communities started to control the space, so they developed some kind of a controlled ownership of the space, so you were not allowed to sell off your property, but it was a community controlled space. And also, just to think about yesterday, also we talked about community controlled space as well, right? Here, yeah. If I understand correctly.
Yeah, that's true, absolutely. The mm-hmm. communal is very important and very evident in your project. One thing I noticed, which made an impression on me, also given the acute circumstances that we're living in now with various Occupy movements and manifestations, there's very little anger, cynicism, or sarcasm in your presentation, in the project that you're presenting. You see this sometimes in other community or social relational projects, sort of a disenchantment with society. You seem to approach this from a very positive point of view.
I think these are
Is this just today behind the stage?
No, these are places of hope for me, because I believe that communities like these are a laboratory of human coexistence, and I think today we should just learn from them. It's very simple.
And in that learning, your position as an artist, you realized the project. Could you maybe say a little bit more how that information or the result of that education, that communal education, is translated to a larger audience? Is that important? How do you go about doing that?
Well, you know, I think people just basically have to do it themselves, but I'm sort of a person, as you mentioned before, on a hopeful side of life, and I think that people really, there are a lot, as we saw also yesterday, there are like tons of projects that are community-oriented today. And I think when they come together and to gain a critical mass, they will, of course, also change the culture of living and influence the institutions that we are involved with today, let's say in Amsterdam, for that matter.
Do you think there's a necessity that in this collaboration, for example, these projects next to each other, that, I mean, I could say you have a great idea here, and I think a lot of politicians probably think about some of your projects that way. Let's drop it in that neighborhood because it must work there. Or if it worked in Caracas and in Amsterdam, let's do it in London. How do you feel about sort of systemizing this or making it modular?
Yeah, it's not about making it modular. It's actually to changing the policies. I think the policies that we live in today and institutions were somehow, they fit to the modernist state of the 20th century. So we have to reimagine the system from below, that's my belief.
The bottom up.
I believe in this.
Yeah. And you mentioned the last question, then I'll take it to the audience, this notion of the participatory democracy. To me, it sounds almost, I think you mentioned it a little bit yourself, like when you buy whipping cream and it says with real cream, it seems to be redundant. It's saying something that it actually already is. So do you agree that that's maybe saying that we actually have a problem when we have to say democracy is
participatory? This is exactly what I mean. We have a problem. This is why we use participatory in front of participatory democracy and participatory design. Yeah, I agree with it.
Are there questions from the audience? Yeah, there's two. Ladies first.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your very interesting lecture. I have, in fact, two questions. In the beginning, you gave a model about the future and the past. And our chairman, he mentioned it already. And then after that, you were talking about the rule and the culture of the city. And I'm just wondering myself, what do you think from the rural part can be introduced in the city? Of course, we had those slides from you, what happens now somewhere in Amsterdam and in Caracas, but how much influence could that have again in its 21st century?
Yeah, it's good that you mentioned 21st century, because 20th century, imaginary of 20th century, was the urban condition. It was the talk of the cities. And during the time, rural communities and rural culture survived. And it proved resilient. And what I say is that they have good ideas that we can think to remake our cities. And no one planned community gardens, but they just happened because people as some kind of part of nature, they seek a way forward, right? In a, I would say, maybe not a subconscious way. They are doing the ritual of cultivating the land in the middle of cities. So that's one example.
Yes, yes, because I was wondering, because at the after Second World War, and in fact, they wanted to build those neighborhoods, but they didn't have results as they wanted to. Mm-hmm. And
well, it was because everything was focused on architecture, and now it's the time of social architecture that bounced back because of the lack of it.
Yeah, that could be an explanation.
Yeah.
At the end of your lecture, you stated that art is a tool to change culture. And that's a nice statement, but I think, how? What do you have in your mind when you are saying that?
Well, there are different forms of art. If I, as I said before, if I work on on-site projects, I call myself artist as a mediator. I'm not an author. And what we have is also not, it's sort of a sharing experience, but it's also, let's say, sharing authorship also with residents. So you suddenly distribute your authorship as well.
Okay, thank you.
There was another question there in the back.
I'm kind of interested in bringing up the issue of taste. You've expressed that the task of the artist is to mediate the relationship with the world. I wondered whether you could say something about whether it's important what type of relationship that the artist fosters, so that supposing, for example, the artist persuaded everybody to turn that back garden into, you concrete it over as a car parking facility where people self-organize and get on and do that. Would that in any way affect its importance to you as an artwork?
I think of myself as a conceptual artist, and first of all, I have to say there are many forms of art. And, you can do various things, but you are a part of the culture. And I think contemporary artists should work in contemporary culture, not reflect the past culture, but contemporary culture. And it seems for some reason that contemporary culture tells you that we have to also invest our time in self-organization and looking for different ways of sharing knowledge and economies. This is also what the girls yesterday from Spain showed very well. I don't know if this answered correctly.
Is that an answer to your question? I think we're going to have one more question.
I'm not sure it does, because I can see that the self-organization would happen all the same under those. I mean, people could use the backyard concreted over for fixing cars in. It seems that there's a very particular type of self-organizing that you're, not in terms of type of self-organizing, but the type of aesthetic that you're after.
Self-organization always used to be put out of the mainstream because it was some crazy people who were doing it, you know, or people in need. But now it became something that we also encounter on a regular basis here. I just would like to point to that.
Okay, thanks.
Sorry, Don, it'll be next time if it's all right. The gentleman back there with the glasses. And maybe I understand maybe to stand up because of the cameras, if you don't mind. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Michael Needham, and I live on the St. Peter's Estate on the Hackney Road in East London. And we've delivered quite a lot of projects on the estate over the last 10 years. And I was interested in you talking about the difference between permanent and temporary. And we make that distinction in our organization. And I think if I heard you right, you were talking about the garden as a temporary structure, a temporary project. And I just wonder if you could talk more about those distinctions between the temporary and the permanent.
Well, Maybe I just go a little bit back in history, and maybe 10 years ago, cultural institutions understood the public space, you know, what is an art in public space 10 years ago. Maybe, just maybe I'm making it too simple, it's an art object. And then everyone accepted the temporary condition. So institutions suddenly started to work with festivals and, you know, some kind of events. It was hard to change, but they did change. And what I learned just now, because I'm also out of Evento now, where I worked on a project Theater Evolutive with US architects from Rotterdam and Paris-based collective Bureau de Tite. What we are doing is actually we worked with residents to redesign public space in the center of the city, where and people now, these temporary structures, supposed to be temporary structures, people want them to stay. So they want them to stay there permanently. The very important thing is to do the right, to have the right relationship with people. You cannot impose, these are not interventions, these are not interventions in the public space where you drop a project and then you go. For instance, in the case of Théâtre Evolutif in Bordeaux, we signed a charter with residents that obliged us and residents to work together. And this is also one of the main reasons that the project is appropriated. And we want it now, we are fighting for it to stay in place. Now, this is one thing. The other thing is this, what I'm saying all the time. The category of space bounced back because we have to do placemaking today. But at the same time, it's not ownership of space, it's control of space. So this is maybe the temporary condition that you were talking about, because these spaces are never permanent, but you have to control the space temporary, but it's nevertheless, importance is the space again.
I think this is a great beginning, because the temporary and versus the permanent, and especially the position of the artist in this, is something that will return later on in the day. We're going to leave it at that. Thank you very much, Marjetica, for this presentation.
Thank you.